something now, the next speaker is a little bit late from Lyon. He's going to speak about large deviations for the largest eigenvalue of
Thank you.
So
I would like to thank the advisor for the invitation to be here and for the great And I'm very happy also to talk here of the subject of the relation for the number and value of random matrices, because somehow we started this subject, I can call it a subject to them here like 20 years ago. So it's just the right time for this presentation. So let me tell you a bit about this question of large deviation in random matrices. So I think it was started by Dan Bolivescu, really in connection with free probability, and he was interested in defining an entropy for non-commutative variables. So he was more interested in defining an entropy for several variables, but in one variable, it turns out that his definition was matching the problem of finding the large deviation for the empirical measure of one random matrix. Okay, we had some argument to compute this entropy, and with Gerard, wrote an article showing that it was matching really large deviation, that this definition was closely related with large deviation, and we derived the large deviation for this empirical measure of the given value of random matrices in the Gaussian case. And then soon after, we worked with Amir, and we were actually considering a totally different subject, which missing the difference, so it was
there's a lot of wine on that table.
Yeah, that's why we did very good articles, you see. Yeah, that was one of my, I was thinking, my God, we are not only drinking coffee to children.
There was no coffee involved.
It was local, and exactly, it was also very sustainable, it was local wine, and we were staying like 3 weeks in the same place for summer school, and now we are drinking coffee upstairs with one. So anyway, so what I was going to say, that we were considering this problem of aging in spherical glasses, and in the course of doing that, we just studied this large deviation for the largest second value of this Gaussian matrices, and it's in the F and X, and actually it was not at all needed for our purpose, but maybe it was some effect of the wine that we were adding theorems, unrelated theorem in the appendix. Anyway, so we showed that there was this large deviation for the largest second value, and this was taken over by physicists like Majumdar afterwards. And so it was a very nice paper. You should read the appendix. And then we got stuck. And actually, so this is, I remember vividly talking with Amir in Abu Dhabi, the swimming pool. So this is a picture of the swimming pool, and we were still very much under the level of water. We never made an argument out of all these discussions, but so we were discussing how to generalize this large deviation to non-Gaussian cases. And this happened to be very difficult, and so it, this question was attacked by some other people, so by Charles Bordelard and Pietro Caputo. And what they consider is the case of Eviter. So Eviter is not really like what you could expect for Eviter, it's just a term which is lighter than Gaussian. So it decreases to zero at infinity like any stretch exponential, but it has to go to zero more slowly than exponential minus t squared. Okay, then what they proved is that there was a large deviation for the empirical measure of the eigenvalues in this case. And Fanny Ogeri, who was a student of Charles Bordelard, showed that there was also the large deviation for the largest eigenvalue. But then again, so what happens for the sub-Gaussian case? And so this is what I want to talk about. And so an idea came out of a discussion with Mark Potters here, so with a physicist working with Philippe Bouchot. And I was discussing with Mark Potters in UCLA more than a year ago, and Mark told me, well, there is something bizarre with one of your theorem with Millen-Mindau spherical integrals. There are some things, two equalities it cannot be. And when we looked together to this equality, which was wrong apparently, I realized that what Marx did not think about was that he should take into account the larger vision of the larger second value. And then, so this was some, this triggered me to think that maybe we can convert this non-inequality in studying the larger vision of the larger second value by using this spherical integral. So this was what we have been working on in Berlin with Donat Rousson, Manu Ogeri and Ben Maida, and this is what I'm going to tell you about. Okay, so now some mathematics. So I consider what you call a Wigner matrix. Okay, so you take independent and n by n matrix with independent entries above the diagonal. They can be real or complex. Independent, so the covariance that are centered on the diagonal, the covariance may be different. It can be it's 2 over beta, so beta is 2 in the complex case and 1 in the real case. So that's the same covariance as the one you impose on the so-called GOE or GUE for the invariant ensembles. And so I will be interested by the eigenvalues of this guy. So there is a very well-known theorem, which kind of the first main theorem in random matrix theory, which is the convergence of the spectral measure. If you take the test function f and you normalize by n, the number of eigenvalues, it will converge almost slowly when n goes to infinity to the integral under the semicircle law. And and you have also convergence of the largest eigenvalue. So namely, if you assume that you have at least the first moment which is finite, then you can see that the largest eigenvalue, which a priori could go away from the spectrum, is sticking to the bulk. Okay, so this is some result of Hodgson converge. And in the case actually where you don't have the first moment which is finite, you may have eigenvalue going to infinity. Actually, you have eigenvalue going to infinity, and this eigenvalue will be created by very, very large entries. Okay? So you, in your matrix, when this condition is not fulfilled, you can ask one entry to be of order one, with big probability, and this will create large eigenvalues. Okay, but so as I said at the beginning, what I want to talk about is large deviations. Okay, so what of the large deviation with respect to this theorem. If I look at the empirical measure, what is the probability that the empirical measure will be close to some other probability measure on the semicircle law? And what is the probability that the largest eigenvalue is not going to 2 but to 3 or 100? So now I'm going to put the theorem under the picture I showed you before. So in the, what is the Gaussian ensemble? So the Gaussian case. In this case, you assume your entries to be Gaussian, and because you choose the covariance appropriately, you can check that distribution of your matrix is invariant by multiplication by left and right by unitary matrices. And this allows you to compute the joint law of second values of your matrix. So this is the only case where you can really do that. You have an explicit law, and here you have the interaction of the eigenvalue, which is due to the Jacobian of the change of variable when you go from the Gaussian and Tree's law to the eigenvalues. So this is very specific to the Gaussian case. To understand the eigenvalues, you just have to study this kind of what is called beta ensembles. Okay? And so from there, you can study the deviations for the empirical measure. So this is a bit, a lot of formula, but not a bit compact. So you look at the empirical measure, and what I'm going to say is that the probability that the empirical measure is in some set A is going to be approximately given by the exponential of minus n squared times the infimum of this right R. Actually, I put E on here. Okay, E is 2 minus. That's all. Okay. So basically, what we prove is that the probability that the optical measure is close to some even larger is the product is equal to minus L squared times the Bayesian copy. Okay, and this E is going to be strictly positive if U is not the semicircle log. This proves again the convergence of the empirical merger to one of the So how do you prove that? So because you have the joint law of taken values, this is kind of very simple. What you do is that you look at your density, and you realize that your density is approximately just a function of your empirical measure. Okay, you put everything in the log. So here I did something a bit wrong because I added the diagonal term here, whereas I should not have diagonal terms. But besides that, this is an equality, and the idea is that once you have this, you can estimate the probability to be close to a measure mu just by Laplace method. Okay, because you've, if you look at the probability that your empirical measure is close to mu, so this will be approximately this as soon as g is continuous. And because you've large deviation around this L squared, the entropy will not play any role until you just get this estimate. Okay, so the only point in this proof is to deal with the fact that your G is not really continuous or things like this. So this, the result with Gérard and Amir about the largest eigenvalue was in the same kind of spirit. So now you don't look at the large deviations for the empirical measure, but the largest eigenvalue. And again, you can look at the density of the largest eigenvalue. So this time, what you do is that you have to integrate your density function over all the other eigenvalues, which are smaller than this eigenvalue x. And then you have to estimate this. Okay. But again, if you put this product with exponential, you realize that this product would be a function of the empirical measure of the other eigenvalues, which should be very close to the semicircle law. And much very close in this with respect to this kind of probability, because it's very close with the probability which is of order 1 minus exponential minus n squared. So you can here replace the empirical measure of your eigenvalue by the semicircle distribution. This is what you do. And you see that your density is approximately given by this formula. Okay, so again, you can do a Laplace method to deduce the large deviation for the largest semicircle. So of course, this is really based on the fact that you have an explicit formula for the density, and it's not clear at all how to generalize this kind of ideas to all the particles. So the work of Bordonnard and Caputo and Fanny Ogeri was quite different. The idea to derive large deviation is completely different. So in this case, as I said, they assume that the entries, so already divided of order 1 over square root of n times some stretch exponential. Okay, so the entries of your matrix are going to be t over square root of n times exponential minus t alpha, where alpha is strictly smaller than t. Okay, and so in this case, what they showed is that the large deviations will have much bigger probabilities. So it will be in the scale n to the 1 plus alpha over 2 for the empirical measure, and n alpha over 2 for the largest eigenvalue. Okay, and we have an explicit rate function which is different from the ones which you had in the Gaussian case. Okay, and how do they prove this? I mean, here I wrote it, but it's kind of very simple. So the idea is, in this case, that the large deviation will be created by having big entries in your matrix. So if you look at the probability that one entry is big, it's going to be of this order. Okay, one entry because it's divided by the square root of n. And so if you want to create one big eigenvalue, it's enough to create one big entry. Okay, if your entry x11 is going to be very big, then eventually you will create one big entry of the order of this x11. And so you see that the right scale of the large deviation is exactly this one. Okay, if you want to change the empirical measure, it's not enough to change one entry, because by inequalities, you know that you will have interlacing of your eigenvalues. You need to change at least something of order n entries, because otherwise this would be kind of finite trend. And when you do that, you see that the scale should be this one. Okay, and when you see what is the optimal way to do this kind of big entry change, what you find is the large deviations. Okay. So it's quite different from the perspective that we use for the Gaussian case. And okay, and so what we have been working on recently is on the sub-Gaussian case. Okay. And so we have a condition which actually I'm trying to find out if people have seen it before. I asked people like Ledoux and somehow they didn't give me any other name, but so we have a condition that the Laplace transform of your measure is bounded by the exponential of t squared times the covariance. Okay, so this will be an assumption about the law of the entries. So you see that here there is no coefficient. So it's if you have a Gaussian law, you have equality. Okay? And we assume that you have exactly this bound. In general, you should have for some Gaussian measure, you should have a constant A bigger than 1. Okay, it should be bigger than 1 because when t is close to 0, this is optimal. So we have this condition that we call sharp sub-Gaussian Laplace transform. And so what we proved with Jonathan is that if the entries of our matrix are satisfying this sub-Gaussian bound, this sharp sub-Gaussian bound, then the large division for the largest eigenvalue will be the same than in the Gaussian case. So you have the same speed and the same rate function. So you could wonder whether there are examples of this, and yet there are. So for instance, if you take Rademacher distribution, then the Laplace transform is going to be the hyperbolic cosine. And you can check that this is bounded by this. And in the case where you have the uniform measure, so here we put minus root of 3, just to match the covariance, just so that the uniform measure one. And then you can also check that this is satisfied. But of course, you have many distributions which do not satisfy this this assumption. So, for instance, one example that you can keep in mind is if you take the Gaussian variable and you multiply by the Bernoulli, this is 1, so you have to divide by root of p. And so then you don't have this bound because at infinity the Laplace transform would go like exponential t squared. About okay, but actually, you have many examples. So did anybody saw this kind of condition before? I look at this here and say, ah. Maybe I should ask Cassandra. Okay. Okay, great. Yeah, because I mean, we gave a name, and then there is always a problem when you give a name to something that it has already several names. Okay, so then the question, of course, is what can you say in the case where this is not satisfied? So we are working on it, but it's still really work in progress. And so the idea that if this supremum is going to be strictly greater than 1, but finite, then under some additional technical assumption I don't want to specify, and if nothing breaks down between the time now and the time we have finished writing it, we have a large deviation principle, but only away from 2. So you would like to look at the large deviation Lower bound, and we can only do that for x greater than n. But what is interesting is that this rate function is different from the Gaussian one. And you can check that because, in fact, when x goes to infinity, this is going to infinity like x squared over 2a. For a equal to 1, it's going to infinity like x squared over 2.
So can you compute the rate
function? Yeah, yeah. We have a formula. We have a formula. I mean, compute. We have a sup of sup and stuff like this. So, depends on whom we talk. But yeah, we have formulas. I will explain how. Okay, so let me give you some ideas of how we do that. And as I said at the beginning, we are using spherical integrals. What are spherical integrals? So we take a fixed matrix here, Y, and we look at the Laplace transform of a random vector, E, YE. Okay, and E is following the uniform rule on the sphere. Okay? And so what we prove with an Ellen Mylord, or at least a tiny Mylord, is that if you look at the log of this guy divided by n, then this will converge to some rate function, g. As soon as we assume that, so y is a sequence of n by n matrices, whose empirical distribution is converging, as well as its largest eigenvalue. Okay? And here theta is positive. So why should this depend on the largest eigenvalue? Well, you can see that for theta very large, what you expect is that E would like to align on the largest, on the eigenvector of the largest eigenvalue. Okay. But actually, so what we have a formula for this guy, so it looks a bit ugly. But so what you can see is that if theta is small enough, so smaller than the Tijan transform, the Cauchy transform of your mother, then this limit will not depend on the largest eigenvalue. This is somehow what you would expect. But if theta is large enough, then it will depend on its largest eigenvalue. And in fact, in this regime, g is more or less like theta lambda. Okay, so it's a bit like the Laplace transform. And so when we did this paper with Millet, so we called it a Fourier transform of a random matrices, because somehow what you can see here is that but the piece is the R transform. So on the R transform in free probability is really the analog of the Fourier transform. So it was making kind of correlation between the R transform and the Laplace transform. But so in this, now this work on our division, what interests most is this dependency. So the regime where theta is large enough, so that this spherical integral is dependent on the Laplace integral. And so once we have something like this, how do we prove large additions? Well, so the idea is to do a tilt by introducing the spherical integral, so that once you have introduced the spherical integral, you will improve the probability to make this deviation to this unlikely value. Okay, so what you do in general is that you divide by your spherical integral and multiply. Okay, here I didn't do anything. Then you use the fact that this guy has some limits, because here I know that the empirical measure is going to deviate towards to converge to the semicircle law. I know it's going to do that with very large probability of order is minus n squared, well, 1 minus n squared. So I can fix here my empirical measure to be the semicircle law. I have fixed here the largest eigenvalue, and so I somehow removed this just by this asymptotic. And then, as is typical in large deviation, then I forget for the upper bound this indicator function. And then I just do Fubini to compute this guy. So now I first integrate over x. Okay, so I get the Laplace transform of the law of my entry, because this guy has a good idea to be linear in my matrix X. And now I'm going to use my assumption that this is bounded by this Gaussian formula. So what I get here by my bound is just eta squared and I squared ed squared. Okay, so now I can sum over I and j, and this is just going to be 1. Okay, so this gives me the upper bound. A equal 1. And x equal 1, I will move my hands to. This is more complicated. Okay, so that's the case A equal 1. So you get a large deviation upper bound with this right function, and magically it's a right function of the Gaussian case. So, of course, the point is to get also the lower bound. And the lower bound, so we do as usually in large deviation, so we need to show that somehow we have a lower bound for this guy, the expectation of the spherical integral, and we have also, we can find for each x a theta so that this will not go to zero too fast. Okay, so how do you do that? So to get a lower bound on that, you introduce the fact that the EI are small, delocalized, and again you take the expectation over x. Okay. And why was the sharp subtraction hypothesis important? Here it's that here now that I am on this space, this guy will be small. So I can take the approximation of the Laplace transform at the origin, which was matching my upper bounds. Okay. So I do that, I do the approximation at the origin, and I get this n theta squared. And then we have to show the other thing, so maybe I can do that on the blackboard. I don't know which blackboard is the better thing. Okay, which blueboard? Maybe this is the missing anyway.
Yes.
Exactly. You think nobody will see?
Maybe that one is better, I don't know. See, we can read it so they can see that one.
Okay.
Thank you, already see it.
Okay, so what you would like to do is to get a lower bound on this guy. And so what we do is that again we do Fubini and we restrict ourselves to this set of delocalized eigenvector. Expectation of our x of n theta e x e. Okay, and what I want to show is that this is going to go to 1. And then I will multiply by beta. Okay, and why is this going to 1? Well, again, here it's only something linear in x. So under this law, I have again a matrix with independent entries. So I just have to compute its mean and covariance. And if you look at the mean, so this is p theta of xij, so this will be the derivative of the log of this guy. I j, so I have to be careful with the spot of n, x. So the derivative with respect to theta, and then I divide by spot of n theta I j. Okay, so I'm just using that the mean is just the derivative of the log of the Laplace transform. And here again, because this is small, I can use my approximation at 0 and see that this should just be 1 over 2 n theta squared, I squared, e squared. And so what you see then is, what you see is interest under your new law. So if you look at the covariance, this will be approximately one also in this regime. So what you see that your matrix X theta just look like a matrix X plus a round one perturbation. And then you can use the BBT transition to show that so the largest eigenvalue will convert to the theta plus one over theta. Okay, and this shows you that for any x, you can just find one theta, so that this will go to one. And when this goes to one, you can see that the expectation which is left will go to it will just go to this. Okay, so that's this is just constant actually. So this is the proof. So in the case where a is greater than one, the thing is that you cannot. You cannot use this upper bound because then you will get A, and this will not match the lower bound. And so you have to be more careful, and you can get still asymptotics of this guy, but it will be a mixture of EIs which are delocalized, for which you can use this approximation, and EIs which localize. And so you get a more complicated limit. And the problem with this limit is that it will not be smooth in general, for instance, because you will have a transition between the case where you don't have localization and the case where you have localization. And so then it's more difficult to get the upper bound. To get the larger vision, because somehow that's somehow the idea that smoothness of this limit is not guaranteed anymore, and it's more complicated to get it. Okay, so any question? No? So we have another result with the Millen-Nalda on a similar another model, matrix model, which is the case where you look at two matrices A and B, and you rotate one uniformly depending on the merger, and you look at the sum. Okay, so you take two matrices, you conjugate one by an orthogonal or unitary matrix, and then you can ask the same question: what about the large deviation from the largest eigenvalue? And what we found out is that we have large deviation in the case. So here we assume that the largest eigenvalue of A and B are converging to the boundary of the support. And under this condition, then we get a large deviation principle as well. So actually, this result is extends to the case where eventually A and B can have eigenvalues going away from the bulk. But in such a way that almost surely the largest eigenvalues of this sum will still stick to the bulk. And in fact, there are issues when this is not the case, because then you could ask large deviation above the limit and also below. And if you start looking at large deviation below the limit of this guy, then you have to do other type of assumption, actually. You have to do assumptions on the smallest eigenvalues, for instance. So that's a different one. Okay, so some comments. The method is robust, so in the sense that we can use it in other frameworks, such as V-sharp matrices. As I said, so the right function that we get, I didn't say that, but in the case A greater than 1, actually, even if our limit of the annealed energy would be smooth, we would have a problem that it's not optimal next to next to 2. So we are not able to get a large deviation for small deviations at this point. And there is a natural question of the extension to the large deviation for the amplitude measure. And in the case of Wigner matrices, I have no clue how to do that, but with Jiang we are trying to do the case of the unitary model, the invariant model, and I hope that it will work out.
Questions?
In the walk with Nick, we got the last deviations for the Bernoulli, but for the maximal eigenvalue, but really very, very far from the start of Bernoulli, but far from the threshold. This was coming with a localized. This was coming from one localized eigenvalue. I think maybe if one tries to push that case towards the edge, you will get a mixture of localized and delocalized.
Yes.
You know.
Okay. So in what we are doing, I think we can do this deviation for still deviation of the order of the eigenvalues, and then what we see is a mixture of localization and delocalization. So that's really, we have a transition in this large deviation between the case where the eigenvector is completely delocalized, in which case we expect that we have the Gaussian reduction, and the case where we have some localization of the eigenvector, but still a delocalized space, in which case we get this other type of red function. It should be easier because somehow then you can neglect the delocalized. Here the mess is because we have this mixture.
Other questions? Not much. Thank you.